I'm Dave Palumbo, founder of Species Nutrition. I created Species Nutrition with one mission in mind, to provide bodybuilders and serious athletes with no-nonsense supplements that work and are backed by science. From my earliest bodybuilding days, I believed in only putting the best in my body. And that lives on in the Species Nutrition line of products. We use only top-of-the-line formulations, dosed for maximum results, and the best flavoring systems available. I put my name and reputation on every bottle of Species Nutrition products. If you want to be your absolute best, join the evolution.
After working hard at the gym, you need a mattress that works as hard as you do. Spinaline has engineered the perfect mattress for you and your active lifestyle. Don't compromise your recovery with inferior sleep. Order your Spinaline mattress today.
As we sit here at the Last Supper, we must thank the Lord and take pause. Jesus, what's the
Welcome to another episode of After Hours. I'm Dave Palumbo, and I'm back again with John Romano here on this beautiful August 11th, 2020 afternoon here. And it's supposed to be nighttime, but you know, hey, you gotta record when you can record, right?
It's still after hours. We just have determined which hours these are. So
I have my Valentino.
Are you having Valentino on today?
Supposedly everyone's coming out, but I have my Valentino sunglasses on. I went to the eye doctor. So, I got to tell you, and you probably feel this more than I do because you're 60. I'm only 52. The older I get, the more I become like my father. As we all know, that happens. That's inevitable. But now I'm getting all the ailments that my father had. Like now I have like a cataract in my left eye. Now my left eye is my bad eye because when I was in first grade, I got hit with a rock. Some kids were throwing rocks at the monkey bars. One ricocheted off, hit me in the eye. So I haven't really had good vision in that eye for my whole life. Mm-hmm. It's funny. Everyone on this show, Valentino, everyone has a bad eye. So
not me.
Both
of my eyes are bad.
Yeah. So I mean, I wear contact lenses now. Now that I've hit 50, I can't read. So I have my contact lenses. I can see distance now, but I can't see close. I know you can't either. You're always popping the glasses on. And you used to when you were in your 50s, you were just holding everything at a distance from you, right? So now I got a cataract, but they said it's not. It's a 3 out of 4. So they wait till it's a 4 out of 4 to do the surgery on it. Right. So that'll be probably next year. I'll have to get a cataract surgery. Luckily, mm-hmm. I don't have glaucoma like my father. I don't have any pressure problems in my eyes.
I don't know how any of these people that I hear of getting cataract, glaucoma, or just the LASIK, any of these procedures where they block your head in this vice, and then this machine comes down like into your eyeball. You have to put me out for that.
It's called having kids, John. If you have young kids, I could fall asleep anywhere. I fell asleep getting a tattoo. That's how tired I am.
Yeah, fall asleep getting a tattoo. I don't know how anybody can do that. But to get that in your eye, I mean.
They numb your eye so you don't even feel it in there.
It comes into your eye, like you can't not see it.
Let me tell you something. I've been wearing contact lenses for 30 years or something like that. And you could take your finger and poke me right through to my brainstem, and I wouldn't even close my eye or blink because you become so desensitized your eye when you wear contact lenses that literally I can grab my eyeball and it wouldn't hurt. So I think I'm not going to have as big a for me, it's the idea of what they're doing in my mind that's fucking me up. Yeah.
Right. And and especially you with the medical background, compartmentally piece by piece what's going on. And then you got this robot arm coming down into your eye. Like
crazy, right?
I mean, come on. You move 1 millimeter the wrong way.
I know. I want to be immobilized. I don't want to be able to move. I'll be like, look, whatever you got to do, I don't want to be able to move. I don't care what you do to me. Just anchor me down. Look, if my dad got through 2 cataract surgeries, my father, this is how stubborn he is. He got one done. And all he did was complain after that. And you probably heard him because I think you were up there then. Remember he was complaining that he looked like he was seeing through a barbed wire fence.
Yes.
He was going, I said, Dad, that's because you haven't had the other eye done. He goes, hey, what are you talking about? I'm not going to get it done. Then I'll see double. He thought it was going to be like doubly as bad. I said, no, you're seeing good out of one eye and then the other one is fuzzy. So I think it's creating this artificial, artifact. He's like, no, you don't know what you're talking about. So he waits a year and a half, 2 years. Finally, he goes to the eye doctor. The guy's like, Sal, your cataracts, you got to get this done, the other eye.
Right.
He's like, fine. Because what he did was he got the bad eye done first. So he wasn't seeing that eye any. Right, another one. That's another one. One bad eye. That's another wonderful thing. I don't even have to inherit it genetically from him. I got hit in the eye to equilibrate my bad eye to his eye, He had double hip replacement. I had double shoulder. We both had appendix at 17.
And I both tore our same bicep.
Did you?
Yep.
It's genetically we're vulnerable to our genetics. What can I say? So they die. I've never had my eyes dilated so much. If I took these sunglasses off, I look like I just went. I took 14 ecstasy pills. That's how my eyeballs look. Because I get the blue eyes. Especially in the sunlight.
They're
black. I look like the devil himself. I went into the bank. They were like looking at me like because they see me all the time. They're like, what the fuck's wrong with this guy?
We take our eyesight so for granted, the actual miracle that is. The other day I was out on my motorcycle, I'm riding, and I got, my full face helmet. And right out of freaking nowhere, I'm in a turn, I'm committed. I'm like leaning over, pretty far into a turn. My head is off to the side because I'm looking into where the direction I'm going, and I see a dot like this, like hovering, around. And I'm not going to change my path for that thing, but sure. I would have it smack, right? And I'm thinking to myself, is that that could have been a bug, a pebble, a bullet. It didn't matter. It was there was a projectile.
Yeah.
And, of course it splattered on my face shield and made a mess.
Well, at least you have a helmet on. That was smart.
And that's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking, holy shit. So many guys ride with just like sunglasses like that, with no helmet or whatever. And, because they want to feel free and whatever, your whole thing with a bike. But that fucking bug, man, if I had just had sunglasses on, it would have gone right through the freaking lens, I'd be like you right now.
They had that Sturgis Bike Week. I think it was this past week.
Yep, all my brothers out there
helmet,
no
face mask. They're like,
no
fuck
mask,
it.
No helmet. Fuck it. They're peacefully protesting. Yeah. What's wrong? I mean,
the funny thing is Sturgis has. They're like, we're getting a lot. They were saying how they. They brought in all this extra medical something or another's, and they brought like there's only like 5,000 people in the whole town.
But when the bikers get there, it's 250,000.
Oh, I know. I don't even have a economy. I would imagine Sturgis is probably the whole economy there.
Oh, I went a couple of times when I lived in LA. Oh man, I rode it. Yeah, one of the times we rode all the way out there. That was a trip to remember. But the next time I went on a trailer, that was way better. Yeah. But man, you want to be, it was more impactful when we rode there because it was a pack. We about eight of us went, one from LA. We started out at about 12, but only eight made it.
And really? How many hours is that?
A fucking lot. I know it was 3 days we took to get there. You can't ride a bike like you drive a car, man. It's like riding a motorcycle in the wind like that. Not like a cruise, but not like a Gullwing, but like a real motorcycle.
Yeah.
It's like being hung upside down and beaten with a bat for every hour that you're riding. It's uncomfortable. Hands go to sleep,
I don't know how people do it for that length of time. I know people may go cross country, like that. I mean,
I've done it. I went from LA to Daytona one time.
Really? Yeah. How long did that take?
That was a memorable experience. It was like it was in the 80s. So I had a really cool bike back then. And it was, I think we did it in six days.
That's brutal, John.
Well, what was more brutal is I was arguing with my girlfriend the whole time. Oh. So she was, and every time I stopped for gas, you know, we make a phone. Back then we used, you know, a telephone and an actual booth phone. Some of you guys don't know what the fuck that is, but it was actually a phone that's hanging outside that you put money in it. Do they even know what money is anymore?
I don't think so. No? I don't think you're allowed. You know, the bank even said we have a change shortage.
Yeah. There was these things called quarters, you know?
You know why they have a change shortage at the bank, John? Because they're not fucking minting anymore.
Who the hell uses change? Pennies. What the fuck uses a penny anymore? Well,
you know what? Once the penny's gone, the nickel will be gone next, and then the dime and the quarter, and then before you know it, the dollar bills will be gone too. So,
well, the change, I think everybody should round up or round down in the nearest dollar and fucking change. It's like stupid. I'll take the hit on that just to not have you. Look, you know what the fuck? You know what I hate?
You give up your penny, you're going to give up your money. I'm telling you.
Okay, here's what happens. $5. The thing is $4.23. Okay. So I'm gonna get that pile of change. All right, it was in my pocket. What do I do with that pile of change? It wasn't $4.23, it was $5. Because I'm never gonna see the change. It's gonna come home, I'm gonna dump it in the ashtray, or I'm gonna put it in the jar or whatever, and then what happens? Someday you're gonna cash that in. It's like it's such a pain in the ass change. We can go cashless as far as I'm concerned because I use plastic everywhere I go. I never pay with
cash. But remember back in the day when you were doing illegal stuff, you know, for those guys, they're not going to be happy
about that. Well, you know, that's why God created Bitcoin. You got to roll with the times. You can't always use cash. Sure. All right. So whatever, man. I'm fine with them getting rid of cash, but get rid of the change. It rounds everything up anyway. You will never spend that you know 72 cents. It's just never going to happen.
Right. No, you never know. My mother-in-law will travel the 20 miles to save a penny a gallon in the gas station. So
well, that goes with that whole generation. They all. You know,
poverty generation.
Yeah, my uncle do. He would drive 30 miles out of the way to save 8 tenths of a cent on premium. You know, because he had it to sell.
So I know you like this story. Let me pull this story up. Did you see the guy suing New York State, Cuomo?
Yeah,
homeowner.
Yes.
The problem is I can't see anything. John had to do all my texting for me today because my eyes just will not.
We're doing a pretty good job. That's good.
Yeah, well, I set it up ahead of time. The funny thing is that they put so much dilator in my eyes. It's supposed to last an hour, John. It's like been 3 hours already. I still can't see. All right, this is the gym owner, Charles DeFrancesco. He owns a gym. That he is now. It seems like every state has one of these guys that's going after the state, the governors here. Guys going after the governor in Jersey. Yeah. You got DeFrancesco, who's got part of a coalition that's suing Cuomo.
Good.
It's not just him.
I didn't know you meant this lawsuit. I thought you meant the other lawsuit that they're filing against him for the nursing home.
No.
Patients. He's getting sued by them too.
What are they saying?
Cuomo is the one who ordered that they put the COVID patients in the nursing homes, which 5,000 people. Fucking moron. Yeah. So now he's being sued for that.
Well, this guy has got a point. He's like, look, the gyms are places for people to get healthy. And guess what? You got liquor stores. Look, this liquor store is open. They consider that an essential business, but the gyms are not open. Why can you go to a liquor store and buy fucking wine and beer and hard liquor when you can't go work out?
And you can buy weed.
Yeah.
How come you can get an abortion, but you can't get a colonoscopy? You can go to Walmart, but you can't go to church? That's the problem with this whole freaking thing. Yeah. There's so much incongruency to how they're handling it. Even the freaking masks. Leave all the science that shows that masks don't work. Notwithstanding. The fact that if you look at 10 people wearing masks, 10 random people wearing masks, 8 of them have it down here with their nose hanging out. Another one's hanging off his ear. Yep. Another one's got it backwards, you know, and they're not even using them right. So what is even wearing them? They're all touching them. They pull it out of their pocket, you know, when they take it out. If you're going to use that man, in spite of the fact that on the box it says it doesn't work, right. But if you're going to usurp that fact and try to insert your whack logic. On a side note, I got to show you this high speed video of a sneeze with a mask on.
Yeah,
they slow it down. It's like a fucking Krakatoa explosion.
Oh, really?
Outsides through the thing. It's like, and you're going to tell me that that freaking mask is right. All you're doing is misdirecting it. It's still freaking coming out all over the place. But besides the point, they're not wearing. They don't even use them right. So what is the point of forcing people to use them? My favorite. My favorite here is you go to the restaurant, you got to wear the mask. I don't, but they suggest, it's on the sign. Mm-hmm. Wear it into the restaurant, and you got to walk to the table. And you get to the table, you can take your mask off. And if you're going to go to the bathroom, you got to put your mask on, walk to the bathroom.
Yeah, it is kind of crazy. If you're going to go to a place to eat, you're not obviously going to wear a mask while you're eating. So
it's like mask on, mask off, mask on, mask off. I mean, like – you know, it's like the plane, and it's the seat in the fucking plane. You recline the seat, you're going to die. Yeah. Seat up here, you're going to live. Die, live. Die, live. Mask, die. No mask, die. It's that fucking stupid at this point.
I agree with you. It's kind of ludicrous in a sense. You know what the masks remind me of? Remember when we were back, I guess it was in the 80s. Remember the first person came out with this baby on board signs on the car?
Yeah.
You put it in the back of your window. It was like suction cup to the window, and you'd see. And then people started making new ones. They started adding like funny stuff like Yoda on board or you know, jerk off on board or devil on board. Everyone had a different one that said something different. That's like the masks. Now we have all these like masks, like the Joker mask,
yep.
A clear one that you can see the people, you can actually drink through it. There's like, it's like a whole business now, you know. My friend, I'm not filming in my studio because I actually quarantined Tyler because he went on a trip last week. But I have Heinz Senior sent me the RX muscle mask. I have to have him send you a couple.
Oh,
they're really cool. They're really cool. I wish I brought it with me. I'm in the wrong place.
So I cannot use that. Brought
it. But he did a really good job on these RX muscle masks, and they're really kind of cool. You might even wear it, John, just because it's cool. But
I might hang it from my rearview mirror like the other guys do, you know, because it's cool. But I refuse to wear them, and nobody says anything to me. I walk into stores, right everywhere. I won't wear it. Nobody says a word to me.
Amanda got me this thing. I really like it because, you know, I have like a big head. So when the normal masks that they sell they're too tight. So it winds up slipping off my ears. Heinz Seniors have adjustable straps on the way. So they really well. But Amanda bought me this thing. It kind of goes over your head and then it wraps around completely. And you kind of just lift it up. I look like I'm in part of the camel crew.
I want to get these hoses put in. You know when you have like a nitrous oxide system on a car, and like before you hit the button, you got to purge it, you know, and then that comes out like the windshield wiper washers, you know, it's spray. Right. I want to get that coming out my nose so that I can push a button and it goes and smoke comes out of my, you know, both nostrils. And then I'll wear a mask if it does something cool like that.
I'm sure you probably gave away $1 million idea right there to actually have.
I bet my boy Logan would love that shit.
Oh, man. Yeah, he would.
We're like a bull, you know, with the smoke coming out of his nose. Yeah, tell him I invented
this. We put a mask on him. We took him for the first time to Target. Because he was going stir crazy, and he wore the mask the whole time. He was really good, actually. I can't even believe it. But that's because he was – if you would have seen him in Target ripping toys off the shelf into the cart, I couldn't put him back fast enough. He had everything. He's like, I'll take this and this and this. I need this nerf blaster and I need this
sensory deprivation from being locked down.
Oh my god. He thinks like he can get anything he wants. He's like, No, I need this and I need that and I need this, I need this ammo. That's his new word, ammo now.
Oh yeah. So he's got the mask. Is he carrying a gun too with the mask?
We don't want him to have a gun in the house, but he's obsessed with these like YouTube videos with the Nerf blast. Everything's Nerf blasters now.
Oh, those are cool.
So he's like, I need ammo.
What about the giant water bazookas for the pool?
That he's allowed to have. But always loses them because he winds up squirting us in the eye. It's really me he squirts in the eye. That's why we don't want to let him have the Nerf blasters. He likes to assassinate you at point blank range, you know? He puts it right to your fucking head and
I love that kid.
So he needs ammo now. I was thinking about when Max was a kid and he was like, he needed body armor and Halo when he was playing Halo.
Oh, remember the man? He had that certain mask. Yeah.
I know my son's going to be the same way. I'm really.
Just wait. He's going to need the hologram. Can you imagine how advanced that's going to be?
Oh my God!
When Logan was
5 years.
At Max's, gaming age. Holy shit.
5 years alone, the video games will probably be insane.
Come on. I still think the robot thing is the cool.
Oh yeah. I can't wait till I have I'm hoping that by the time John we're like 70 that like we can have robots like serving us. Like I'd like to have a whole staff of them. Like
I want to see you're going to think I'm crazy, but I want the sex robots. I want to see them perfect them because I'm going to sit
back perfected first for sure.
I'm going to sit back and watch the women freaking implode, meltdown because you know what's going to happen? The guy's going to say, what are you going to put up with this shit for? I'm going to have a Cherry 2000 over here, man. And listen to shit. I'm going to keep it in a closet in the bedroom. Hey, babe, come on out. And then go back in the closet. And then I'd have a beer, watch the game, go to the races. Who's going to bother me, And this whole concept of the relationship and all of this give and take, that's going to go right out
there. It's already out the window. You can't even fucking hang out with anyone because you have to wear a mask and you're quarantined.
Even better.
Yeah.
Yeah. But this isn't going to happen until after the election anyway. So the masks are going to be gone November 4th. But as this robot technology increases, because the pervert brigade is out to go out to get one of these sex robots, perfected. I there's teams of wackos out there working on that. And they're going to come through to, Russian, Japanese, whatever. It's going to happen. And the minute it does, the second they have a viable humanoid crazy maniac nympho sex doll that works perfect, there is going to be a crash in our society like you have never seen before. So suddenly a giant number of men are going to perceive the fact that real women are superfluous. Hey, what are you going to put up with their shit for? I get what I want over here.
Alter right there, John, right?
What's that?
It's your population control issue too.
They don't want kids. They just want a porn star, a live porn star in the house.
What I'm saying, we won't have to worry about population.
And of course, they're not going to get shit done. The productivity is going to go down the toilet because they're going to have menage a trois with fucking artificial porn stars 40 hours a week, and so no one's going to get a goddamn thing done. And then you're going to it's going to be the most insane. The guy that cures baldness won't even get on the map.
Right. But the problem is they'll have us chemically castrated by them probably already.
This will ruin humanity, and it's going to happen. Yeah. And I hope it happens in my lifetime because I want to watch it.
Yeah. I just want servants. That's all. I want some servants that I don't feel bad telling them what to do. You know what I mean? Because I don't really want humans. I'd love robot servants that just I could just, I can make like funny. Like I could have like one guy look like Arnold or Lou Ferrigno. I could make another one like Ronnie Coleman. Wouldn't you love to have Ronnie Coleman like in his Olympia shape, like just like, being your butler?
Just the torso.
Think about the staff of fucking the Blackman would have. If he stole.
God. He would just have people have busts of people. Blackman would have like the glutes,
he'd have Kai, Victor, all the you'd be getting like Anna Nicole Smith, he'd be having like Kai, Victor,
But it would only be like the waist would be
you'd have robots. You said you sex robots, so you could get the man.
He's only interested in the glutes. So he would have them roaming around on wheels, just like from the knee to the waist. Just that part with the striations, and then he would just sit on the couch jerking off when they're moving all around, like a maze. That would be
like 110. It'll have like a whole
every new USA winner, and
yeah,
there's gonna get like
the Jack, get me a can you get me a Hunter Labrada?
He'll be telling like his grandkids, yeah, you want to get me a present? Get me a Hunter Labrada.
Just the glutes.
Now he needs the whole robot experience.
Oh my God. So
Steve, you're 110. You can't drive.
He'll live now.
Actually, no one will be driving. You won't have to.
This would be the best invention for me anyway. I want a box you can roll the motorcycle into, shut the door, and then 10 minutes later, pull it out, and it's freaking perfectly clean.
There you go. Spotless.
All the grannies, the little – that thing takes forever to freaking clean, man. It's got so many little, you know, areas. It's frustrating. I got to get a new shirt
with you. When you're going 100 miles an hour and you get bugs getting trapped everywhere. And
I have not gone 100 yet.
No, really? Well, I'm proud
86 was the
fastest. Does it feel like you're going faster or slower when you're on that bike?
The acceleration, once you get up to speed, it's effortless. You don't even notice it. But the acceleration, if you're hard on the acceleration up there, it's the most violent experience I've ever had in my life.
You haven't done a wheelie or anything like that,
have you? Yeah, it's kind of inevitable.
Oh, really? Wow.
Well, I mean, you got to really like lay on it to keep the, you know, it's hard. Sure. On full blast acceleration, it's really hard to keep the front end down.
Right.
Yeah. Especially when you get the revs up. But it's exhilarating. You know what? The 20-year absence, I know that puts me in the category of most likely to die in a motorcycle accident. but I got to tell you, man, I'm so glad I got back on. It's just the most best feeling in the entire world. I'm so glad. Yeah.
You got to do what you got to do. You got to enjoy your life. You know, you're at a good stage now and your kids are all grown up and you can do what you want.
That's exactly it. I waited till the kids grew up and now I'm back where I'm
back. All right. Well, you know what, John, let's take a quick commercial break. And then when we come back, we'll bring in the whack pack.
I'm Dave Palumbo, founder of Species Nutrition. I created Species Nutrition with one mission in mind: to provide bodybuilders and serious athletes with no-nonsense supplements that work and are backed by science. From my earliest bodybuilding days, I believed in only putting the best in my body, and that lives on in the Species Nutrition line of products. We use only top-of-the-line formulations, dosed for maximum results, and the best flavoring systems available. I put my name and reputation on every bottle of Species Nutrition products. If you want to be your absolute best, join the evolution.
Welcome back, guys. We're here with After Hours, and we got the Whack Pack. Happy birthday, Gregg Valentino.
Yeah, happy Thank birthday,
you.
Gregg.
Happy birthday, Greggy.
Thank you, guys. I appreciate it, man.
That's the big 6-0?
Yeah, the big 60. You know?
Wow.
It was last Wednesday, August 5th.
Now, all you guys 60 now, including Mr. G's? No, not you, John? Oh, next year.
I'm next, October.
John's in October. I remember that, yeah?
Yeah. I got what, 90 days?
It's crazy that you guys are all born the same year. Isn't that weird?
1960. Yeah.
Wow. I'm 59.
No, you're not.
Yeah. 1955. Don't tell me I'm not.
I get it.
What year were you born?
1959.
Yeah, November 27.
You're 61, Jimmy, then.
I'll be 61 November.
Oh, okay. All right. But you're 60 right now.
Yeah, he meant right now. He meant he's not 59. He meant he was born in 1959.
Yeah. I was born in 1959. Yeah.
This whole exchange is
sounds a lot older when you're born in the 50s than the 60s. Like I'm 68. You guys are 60. 60 sounds like not as old as 1959, right?
Well, you can just see by all of this how age-related decline, cognitive decline, is relevant. The relevant topic among the ages, because none of us remember what the fuck we're talking about.
I'm so happy you guys are losing your memory too, because it was really concerning me that I was maybe going senile, but you know, like had dementia. But I think it's just old age. It's exactly
what it is. We need nootropics.
I take all the nootropics. It's not working.
You want to? I invented a vape pen that has nootropics in it.
Really?
Right? Really? So you inhale it and you get nootropic high, right? So right after I'm getting gonna go, I got a guy ready to invest in this thing, and then that whole thing happened with the kids and the vaping, and they got to ban vaping, and then and the guy says,
"There's a guy." We have an advertiser that has a pre-workout vape.
Pre-workout vape. Oh, yeah, once I let it out of the bag, it was only a matter of time. Oh,
dude, I do the vape.
We got Mr. G.
The game face. Game face is unbelievable.
Look at this fucking guy.
Mr. G. Hey. New
York. Hey, what's up, man? So here's the big thing. Every week I get told you can't do it. Intro, no intro. Don't do it. No.
Hey, did you see that guy? You saw that guy, Mike, huh? I saw that.
Mike.
Can you clean
Mike has his own show.
Your lens.
I didn't know that.
He's got cookie dough on his lens.
Cookie dough on his lens. Can you clean your camera, Mr. G?
It's fuzzy. The camera's fuzzy.
I think it's because it's dirty. That's all.
You got flour on it.
Hey, G, thanks for the cookies, bro.
Oh, thank you, Jimmy.
I got him in the mail yesterday.
He got cookies. He got cookies, right?
I got the fucking chips. Everything. I got Dave's big can.
He hooked up, Jimmy.
I got loaded up, man. I was eating chips last night. My asshole.
Hey, John, look right here. See those?
Wow, nice.
Wow.
That's the new. Hey, Dave. That's the new Oreo. You're getting the Oreo, John, and you're gonna get the Believe Bar, which is those. Those peanut butter cups, protein peanut butter cups.
How come Jimmy's 3 hours late to the party gets his already?
We already got that.
Amanda ate one of your cookies with the Oreo cookie, the filling ones. Her blood sugar was like 190, like in 5 minutes after.
Who did?
Amanda.
You got to take it with metformin. You got to eat it with metformin.
She had to take an insulin shot with it.
No, you just got to take a metformin with each
of them. Dude, I want to know.
I just gave Mr. G a great marketing idea. You can take a little pack, a plastic pack, with a metformin pill in there, and you stick it to the.
I got it.
I'm gonna lighten up the cream. I'm going to make the cream the same thickness as an Oreo.
Yeah, I told him that. It's too thick.
So I'm going to make it a lot less.
There's too much sugar in there because it was so thick, too. But you know what? They're delicious. And I'll tell you one thing. I love the macadamia nut ones are probably my favorite, but because I like the white chocolate chips and I like the macadamia nuts in them. They're absolutely phenomenal.
Dave, are you wearing Logan's sunglasses?
Yeah, I am. Because I had my eyes dilated. I was at the eye doctor.
Look at this. Dave, I want to show you guys one thing. So when you cook, in a big kitchen, a lot you store the flour and stuff in these big giant bins, So I had I have 50 pounds of species that I have in this big giant. See this thing here?
Yeah.
Did you drop your phone?
That fits 50 pounds of species protein.
Nice. Unfortunately, I didn't sell it to him. So I don't know where he got it.
What's that?
Nothing. I'm just kidding.
Hey, I just saw Jimmy the Bull. Jimmy the Bull sent me some video, bro.
Where is Jimmy? Oh, there he is. Okay, right.
Jimmy, how much were you lifting in that video? Do you remember?
Yeah, that was one of my fans sent me that video. I wasn't even mine. It was about 765 or some shit.
Wow.
I think it was, 765 is what it was.
Wow. I remember spotting you reverse benching like 600 or whatever the fuck that was. That was crazy. I was praying to God you did not fail because I wasn't able. I couldn't lift that off yet.
I did an appearance with Jimmy. I was announcing on stage. He's gotten 225 on the curl bar, curling up like up to his head like this. Then he picks up a 180-pound dumbbell and starts doing kickbacks.
I did it. Same shit. Me and him were at the Women's Extravaganza, and he was reverse benching.
Yeah.
He had a lot of weight on there. A lot.
I pissed him off because he had four. He was doing something. He had four plates, and I said, and he said that's 405, and I'm like, no, Jimmy, that's really only 395. And he got on stage in front of everybody. He got all pissed off. Put another 25 on each side. It's not heavy enough, you motherfucker.
Is this the video, guys? Is this the video? 765?
Yeah, there it is. No, that's when he did 1,000. That's Eric Mosley.
That's 765 right there.
I did it double, Dave.
There's 855.
This is insane.
Watch this. He can't even cheat because the weight's so heavy, it just goes right down to his chest. He's
got standing right there. I was right there when he was doing that. The 1,015 is what's fucking nuts.
Yeah, refused to spot him on that, right?
No. You got to play that one. The 1,015. When he went out like this, he only did was take the bend out of the bar. You know, this was an old school Olympic bar. Everybody's standing around saying, "A fucking bar's gonna snap." Every 10 guys, I'm standing right there. He goes, that bar is going to snap. And Jimmy just goes like this, and the bend just goes like that out of the bar. We played it.
Let me tell you something. I was the only one spotting him, so I was in the middle. So if he fucking got
stuck, an impression on everybody, man. They had two guys on the end because I pushed the weight up, only the bar bent. And then then the plates came later. You know, so when I came back up, the bar was bent. I couldn't get it back in the rack. The guys had it kind of like cup it, so the fucking bar was straight now, so I didn't get it back.
No, you hit the thing. You hit the stop on the way out, but the collar wouldn't even fit. He had to use duct tape.
I duct taped the end, like I do to my truck.
Yeah, there's like the one up there in your ceiling. You know
what Dave, I got to ask. Can I tell a quick story? Because I don't really have like a long time. My brother called me up. He had a bad day. You know, he left me this message that he's struggling with the kid, the college, the bills, the farm, the car's fucked up. His boss, he called up his boss. They're very scrutinized. You know, every day they account for every dollar and nickel. My brother goes, "How many hours do I got overtime this week?" And she says, "Oh, you got the 22.3.7. You know, they drive me crazy, right?
Yeah.
So he leaves me all these messages. So I finally call him back because, you know, I didn't answer right away. And I said, "Anthony, you want to hear what kind of fucking day I had? I'll tell you what I said, yesterday I worked. I dropped the car at 5 o'clock in the morning, my Jeep, because I had to get the brakes fixed for the sixth fucking time. The same guy, okay? Then I fucking went to work. I came back late because I worked late last night. And a fucking guy locked my car in the fucking fence. I couldn't get the car out of the fucking thing. So Sparky, my co-worker, he says, "What do you want to do?" I said, "What do you mean what I'm going to do? I got no car. You can drop me off home." So he drops me the fuck off home, okay? I said, "Fuck it, I'll take my Harley. I go to the supermarket, I'll get my lunch, I'll do what I got to do." I drop you off, I go to my bike, I go, "Holy shit, the fucking Harley, the key is with the Jeep. I don't have a fucking bike, nothing." So I can't go to the supermarket. All I had was, I boiled a hot dog last night. That's all I got to have a fucking dinner because I couldn't make it to the fucking supermarket, right? So now I get up, Sparky goes, "Don't worry, I'll pick you up in the morning at 4 o'clock. I said, "Sparky, don't be late, man. I got to be on the LaGuardia at 6 o'clock. I'll be there at 4 o'clock. I get up at 2:30. I shit, I shower, I get all my shit ready. I'm waiting at 4 o'clock. I'm 4:05, 4:07. I got to call this motherfucker. I call him up, no answer. I call him again, no answer. I said, "What am I going to do now? I got to get the fucking yard." I said, "Fuck it. I got a bicycle outside. Let me take that motherfucker." I jump outside. I grab the bicycle. I strap my fucking bed to the back of the fucking rack. I got a flat tire in the front. I said, "Jesus Christ." I take the fucking bike, and I'm hauling down New York Avenue. Fucking 4:30 in the morning. I'm sweating my balls off to get to the fucking yard. I finally get to the yard. I'm almost to the yard. Sparky called me. He goes, "Hey, Jay, where are you?" I said, "What do you mean, where am I? I'm almost at the yard. What the fuck are you talking about?" He goes, "I'm at your house." I said, "At my house?" I said, "Well, I'm almost at the fucking yard." He goes, "I'll be right there." I said, "Right there for what?" So all of a sudden, he shows up, and now he's riding behind me with the flashes on, right? I said, "What am I getting escorted?" He goes, "No, in case you have a heart attack."
He probably looked like Mrs. Gulch from the Wizard of Oz.
I said, "Look at me. My life's going backwards. I'm on a fucking bicycle going to work with my fucking cool bag. What the fuck is wrong with this picture, right?" So I get to the yard. Sparky parks the truck. I get out. I'm off my bike. He goes, "Jim, could you do me a favor?" I says, "What, Buck? I gotta go. It's late. It's a 10:05 now." He goes, "I need air in my tire." I said, "You need air in your fucking tire?" He goes, "Yeah, I gotta borrow your hose." I said, "Take the fucking tire. I got 3 minutes to give you." I fucking airing up his hose. I fucking get out of done. I throw the hose back I'm taking off. I go to the fucking 7-Eleven because I got fucking 100 degrees out here. I said, let me get some fucking water. I pull up 7-Eleven. I put my goddamn mask on. I go into 7-Eleven. I sorry, buddy. So I go over there. I got a fucking coffee and a whole case of fucking Palm Spring. I pay the lady. I walk out. I got the Palm Spring in my left hand, coffee in my right hand, mask on my face, 100 degrees. I'm running to the truck. I'm saying I'm going to get a fucking heart attack today. I know it. I can't even breathe with this fucking mask on, right? So I finally made it to the job. I finally made it to the job. I get home last night. I got to pay my cell phone bill. I'm still irate for the whole fucking day because I still got to pay this fucking bill. Go home. I call the motherfuckers up. Press 2, press 3, press 2. Who's your mother's maiden name? What year were you born? Well, how tall, how big is your foot? I said, just want to pay a fucking bill, motherfucker. Right? I can't get nobody on the fucking phone. They do this shit on purpose, right? So I grab the phone. I start hitting the thing. You know, the numbers, right? I'm losing. I'm just going like this. And anything. 9-2-3-5-7-9-5-5. All of a sudden, the lady answers, can I help you? I said, Jesus Christ, is that what it takes to get somebody on the fucking phone? I gotta go fucking berserk. You people make me crazy. I can't. There's gotta be a better way. Click. I said, you gotta be fucking kidding me. Fucking bitch, just, it took me a half hour to get this motherfucker. She just hung up on me. I made his fucking day feel better. My best thing is now, tonight when I go home, I gotta get my bicycle and bicycle to the fucking Jeep. Because I got no fucking car at the yard.
Now, what happened to your car? I missed that in the beginning. Why isn't your car working?
I had a fucking big fix like fucking 6 times with this fucking cocksucker. Every time I go to fix the brake, I go down the road, everything's falling out of the back. I look in the mirror, I see parts flying out of the back. I went back like 3-4 times and I said, listen, brother, you gotta get this shit right. I can't keep coming back here. I need my fucking Jeep, bro. All right, goes, leave it here 5 in the morning. I'll take care of it. And then he locks the thing up in the fucking yard. I can't even get it.
Oh, it was locked in the yard. I that's what I missed. Okay.
Yeah, it was locked in the fucking yard. That's why I got to walk out and take me to my house. I figured I had the Harley, but my key is on the fucking G key, which he has. I ended up on a fucking bicycle, 60 fucking 1 years old.
God bless, bro.
You know, if I was diagnosed with some incurable disease, you know, I would just call Jimmy up and listen to one of these stories, and I wouldn't feel so bad.
Yeah. What was who did that therapy? I mean, there was a guy who was also, he was like terminally ill, and he just surrounded himself with just funny movies and
Pat Chatham.
What was his name?
That was Pat Chatham. Robin Williams did it. That doctor that used to make little kids in San Francisco.
He laughed himself.
I think you should send Jimmy to the nursing home, you know?
Dude, I would have killed to see what Dave said when Dave said that, like, Miss Gulch. I could just picture Jimmy with that.
With
cars beeping at him. Imagine cars beeping at him, and he's looking at him like, what?
No one knows what we're talking about. When I was a kid, when I watched The Wizard of Oz, I loved it. And because it was only on once a year. I don't remember what holiday it was on. And when she would turn into the witch, I was so scared.
No, the scary part was when those bat things came in through the forest. Yeah,
I agree with him. There was something about that witch. You were looking around in your room after watching that.
Margaret Hamilton was such a good witch. It was unbelievable. Yeah.
No, she was great, but the scary part was those flying monster
bats. The flying monkeys.
Yeah. Those things scared the shit out of
me. Picture Jimmy on a bike and a big fucking bunch of flying monkeys behind him. Behind Jimmy.
No, I want to see Jimmy riding his Harley down the yellow brick road.
Exactly. Let's watch Jimmy bench press. Hold on a second.
You got 1,000? Oh, good.
Listen, Gregg, the shit of these stories I'm telling you, Gregg, is my life, bro. I can't help what happens to me. It's fucked up, bro.
Dude, I'm the same way. Normal shit fucking doesn't happen to me.
It's the
same
one I play. Which one?
No, what? That's the
one. Oh, I think it's a different one. I thought it was a different one.
Yeah, no, it's the one after.
This says 1070, 1015.
That's the one here.
No, this is it. This is it, I think. Hold on.
Everybody thought that bar was going to snap.
1,000 pounds. How about 10, 15?
Oh, boy.
Yeah, the weights didn't add up.
Here it goes. Look at him giving the sign of the cross. You better, you do better do the sign of the cross.
You bend? That way. How much that bar is bent?
Who are those guys hold spotting you there, Jimmy?
Those are two bikers, power lifters, and Eric Mosley.
Look at that.
That's, you know what? That's fucking balls right there. It was fucking 15 years later before somebody actually did it.
That shirt was like, it was like a, like an Ace bandage he had on, you know?
It wasn't was not like shirt.
I like Jimmy's ass in those spandex.
We lost Jimmy. He disappeared.
He said he didn't have much time today.
He looked like Hank. You know.
Bro, I spotted him, but I was by myself and on a stage. And I kept saying to him, please, 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 please get this on your own. Because if he couldn't get it, I don't remember, 600-700 pounds, but reverse bench, reverse. And he got it on his own. You know what I mean? I want to just say something about you guys out there that don't know Jimmy. I know you see these spotters on the side, and it looks like they're lifting it with him. They're not, bro. They're not. They're just there in case something happens. You can't wait till it's crashed.
I found it. Here it is. There's Jimmy. There's Jimmy on the bike.
No, you know what the best is? When Miss Gulch is riding it and the house is up in the air and she's looking out in a hurry, you know, she's in the...
That's when it scared me, when she turned into the witch. Yeah.
When she was up in the air.
She goes from Mrs. Gulch into the witch on the broom.
So do you remember Anya Schreiner?
Yeah, of course.
Okay.
Of course.
So I'm doing an exhibition... At co-emceeing an exhibition, it was her and me on a stage with a microphone. Jimmy the Bull is going to do a...
Why do we have... Oh, someone's echoing. I don't know why we're echoing all of a sudden.
It's Jimmy. Hey, I'm back. Come on.
All right. There he is. So Jimmy the Bull is going to do a strength exhibition. Now you got Anya Schreiner's on the microphone. Right. You know, talk. She doesn't know anything about Jimmy. She's ad-libbing. She's fucking it all up. So like, I'd say I'd take over. Just while she's talking, Jimmy is backstage. He's warming up. All you hear is stuff smashing. He's got folded metal chairs and throwing them, smashing them against the wall. He's got, you know, 130. He's got weights on the bar. He's picking, he's throwing them down, smashing, growling. And Anya Schreiner's out there. She's out in front of like 1,500 people. She doesn't know what to do. She's like, I down the microphone, and she's like, you know, panicking. You know? Jimmy's warming up, and I got, you know, I took the mic and I go, it's Jimmy. He's just warming up, you know. And then the freaking audience went nuts when he came out.
John, do you remember when Jimmy would do that? Sometimes his girlfriend Rita would fucking spot him. You remember Rita?
Yep.
Well, he said she used to stand him. She used to ruin the show for him because she'd steal the thunder from him.
Right.
No, she told me. He told me she stole his Anadrols out of his fucking. Out of his top draw, bro. She would stand there. She'd be like him. He should have married her, bro. They were fucking. They were
in a pod.
Mirror image.
That's not good. Too volatile.
Oh,
you imagine the arguments between.
Oh, I know.
Well, they ruined Ed Connor's house. You remember?
I thought that was Jimmy by himself. He went on.
No, that was Jimmy and Rita. They punched holes in the wall.
On a
dude. Ed Connor's house.
Yeah,
dude, Rita would fight guys like John, Jimmy.
Speaking of that, Ed contacted me. I guess the people who bought the Gold's Gym franchise in Germany reached out to him. They want to involve him in the Gold's Gym franchise, so he's all excited about that.
They'd be smart to do that.
Yeah, that's great. Best of both worlds.
They want to involve Ed or
Ed. Yeah. They want to involve Ed Connors in
the they should bring all the guys back who started from the day one. You know?
Well, I think Ed was the brains. I don't know how much Pete Gronkowski and Tim Kimber did over there, but I think Ed was doing most of this, right?
Tim Kimber didn't really do much. I was out there. He wasn't doing.
They were just investors. What did Gronkowski do?
Gronkowski's brother was a lot more involved.
Yeah, Pete Gronkowski was, and Ed were like ran the company.
Right.
And, they were corporate.
Gronkowski's brother, Paul. Yeah, and a brother named Paul.
Paul him Gregg, and, I actually he, I bought my Gold's Gym license from him in Mexico.
Oh, oh for you? Paul?
Yeah.
Yeah, he was it's just like the Will and Norm Dabish. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
Will Dabish was, but Norm was the genius behind that.
Oh, I didn't know that. Really?
Yeah.
So Norm was the
Powerhouse Gyms came from the two brothers, Will and Norm.
No, I know them both. They were great. And Norm's not with us anymore. But
no, I know Norm. I mean, I owned the Powerhouse, so I know Norm very well. And Will, okay. But Will was the fucking monster, whereas Norm was the same thing with Paul and Pete. Paul used to take juice, was jacked at one time, but not like Pete. Pete would, if you saw Pete on juice, he was a monster. The minute he went off, you wouldn't even know it's the same guy.
I heard some crazy stories that Gromkowski was taking retarded amounts of drugs.
I saw him with my own two eyes, saw him sitting on a bench in the gym, sitting before his workout, sitting on a bench. He took a bottle of Dianabol out of his gym bag, took the top off, brand new with the plastic, took it off, and he goes, like, pulls the cotton out, and he goes like this.
Yeah, and that was
thing?
Real.
The whole bottle.
I've heard that stories that get to, but that was real deep ball. The blue ones. Yeah,
the blue ones.
500 milligrams. That would have been
SIBA. Right, 500 milligrams.
Half milligrams, but he swallowed the whole bottle.
Oh, unbelievable. Hold on.
Am I back?
Yeah, you're back.
Oh, Jesus.
George, fix your camera.
All right.
I'm in the airport. I think they jammed the phones here for some reason.
Jimmy? Did you ever? Who took more Anadrol? You or Pete Gromkowski?
What happened?
Who took more Anadrol per day? You or Pete Gromkowski?
I don't know. I used to take up to at least three a day. I don't know what Pete was thinking at that time.
I heard you took eight. The rumor is you took eight a day. Is that true?
No, I didn't think. No,
oh, okay.
I'll bet you
I have a fucking liver left. Are you kidding me?
Yeah,
dude. I bet you I've taken four a day a few times.
Really?
Wow.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I've gone up to four, but I didn't stay off. For, you know, I did it for a little while. I mean,
I was taking the Hemogen.
Yeah. Did you get really
shit called, Gregg? You remember the shit called Understore? It was a purple pill. It was you put it under your tongue. It was like a.
That was the Andriol Androxin.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. You put it under your tongue. It was crazy.
What drug made you the strongest, Jimmy?
I have to say I had a nice combo going. I had cypionate, Anadrol, Anavar, and a little suspension.
And hot dog.
Suspension was fucking phenomenal, man.
No, bro, suspension. Oh my god, dude. You take that, you boners and shit. You know what I love? Sten, that dirty drug from Mexico. Sten.
Yeah, with a DHEA in there or something like that too, right?
Oh hey, Greg, my
god! When I was living in California, that Sustanon just came out with that. Is that with that fucking dot in the little plastic coffin, right?
Yeah, preload. I took.
Yeah, right, preload. So I didn't know anything. I was stupid those days. So you know, I took the fucking thing out of the foil, right? And I just stuck it in my. Fucking ass, man. And I was like, holy shit.
It was like a 14-gauge needle.
It was like a 7-gauge needle.
You could do a biopsy with that needle.
When I pulled it out, my fucking ass skin cheek, you know, everything came with it. Like, oh cheek. You know, and I fucking blood was shooting out. I was like, what the? So then my friend said, no, man. He goes, just pull the plunger out of the back and draw it out with a regular fucking dog. And he goes, you can't. That's a fucking harpoon, man. What's wrong with you? I said, I don't know. I just.
It was like a dull nail, too. God, it wasn't even sharp.
Dude,
like
a ten penny nail.
Like taking a 10-penny nail, just shove it in your ass.
I loved it. I love those big nails. You know why? Because you don't sit there and struggle. You just go like that. It's
Gregg, what was the cheapest you ever got those ready jacks for when you were buying volume?
Sustenance?
Yeah.
Yeah,
paying like $10, $12 a piece.
No, I know, but he was buying thousands. How much were you paying?
$2 maybe.
Wow.
Well,
how much? Those are like $25 a piece now in the pharmacy.
Dude, I was See, what people don't realize, when I was a drug dealer, I didn't sell to the kid in the gym. I sold to all the drug dealers.
Right,
you know what I mean?
Right.
So I would get in volume. Sometimes I would get a box, and I would never even like, here's the box. I would just hand it over. Yeah. I never even looked in there. You know what I mean? I could tell you stories. Woo! You know, I would never even look.
In Mexico for $3.
Did they?
I used to get them $2. You know what the best was? when you would buy the Dominican shit, I would go to Washington Heights and the Dominican pharmacies. I would go with a, you know, with a Dominican bodybuilder, wink, wink. And we would go in there because he was Dominican. They all knew him and he spoke Spanish. I didn't speak Spanish. Right. We'd go in there and we would come out with fucking anabolics. Dude, I'm telling you, I paid $2 to $1.50 to $2 for that shit. Boxes. And that was, you know, and I would even get Ganibals from this person.
Hey, guys.
Hey.
I used to love those Anabar, the shield made of a blue can with a white metal.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, the old, that's real Anavar.
But those were only 2.5 milligrams, those pills. They were very,
yeah, you know, but those things are fucking unbelievable. Dave, those things, I did two in the morning and two at night. I got hard as nails on them fucking things, man. They were unreal.
Dude, people today
don't those things make you strong, those Anadrol. I had strong ligaments like Jimmy. I used to do curls with like 315.
I've done it.
Jimmy was saying the Anavar, though. He would use 4 Anavar a day.
Yeah, but the difference is that shit was real. It's like these kids today show me these D-balls, and they're 50 milligrams. I'm like,
Greg, Upjohn, Rugby.
Upjohn, Rugby, Steris.
That was all the fucking good shit, man. Yo, my own!
Well, Chris and Cito told me that him and Bob Grushkin would get off the bus, and they'd at the corner store, and they go in the pharmacy, and Bob had like a connection there, and he would pick up a bag of just like real like Anavar and testosterone.
You're talking about Charlie.
Yeah.
Right?
Oh, is that Charlie? Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Greg, you'll remember this. The drug.
Uncle Charlie, right?
The drug used to drop these boxes at Gold's Gym at the counter, and they used to drop off different all the bodybuilders would make their orders, and the drug reps would just deliver them.
Really?
There was a story, like, I know that Arnold used to talk about, like, it was like every, you know who the best is to talk to? Leon Brown. Leon Brown's got, oh, yeah, every Wednesday they would get a delivery, you know, and for the UPS guy, they'd all be waiting outside for the UPS guy.
The funny thing is no one abused the stuff. Everyone was like, oh, yeah, give me one bottle of this and one
bottle
of that.
Oh, dude, I heard that Arnold used to pop 100 fucking D-balls.
Oh, he did?
I don't know if it's true. We don't know what's true because I wasn't there.
Right.
But, you know, Leon Brown's got
some. What do you think about the D-ball, Greg, those little pills years ago? You think they were any good, them fucking things?
You know what? I never took those because I started taking steroids.
I never took them either. I had a lot of friends that took the D-ball.
I'll tell you what I loved them. In Polish, Metanabol, which was deep. Oh, my God. That shit was fucking, that was D-ball like no other D-ball you could imagine. You know, and I did like the Russian D-balls and the Russian sustenance.
Well, I got used to get those, remember the Thai D-balls? There was 1,000 in a bottle.
Yeah,
the original ones that came over were very good. The original ones.
But then after that, they were like fucking, I think they were chalk pills.
They
faked
them. Yeah, they faked them.
Yeah.
Dude, but Metanabol. They were coming in an orange strip like
this.
Yeah,
no, I remember.
Oh, my God.
How about Czech drops? Remember those?
And those are the ones that, what's his name used to sell them?
Czech drops were for strength. I'm sure Jimmy probably tried them once or twice.
Sure, he did.
Wait, what's it? Rodney Roller.
Remember the thiomucase they used to use?
Let me tell you a good check drop story. I'll tell you
a good check. With the cellophane.
Someone gave me a bottle of check drops, and I had it sitting in my drawer for probably 2-3 years. So I'm going to try it at the gym because it's supposed to make you super, super strong. They would give it to dogs to keep, female dogs to keep them out of heat or something like that.
Right.
And I didn't have a dropper. So I took like a spoon and I poured some in a spoon and I put it onto my tongue. Big mistake. I took probably 100 times the dose you should have. I had indigestion for fucking 3 days. So bad. I felt so nauseously sick from it. But in the gym, I was so strong that I felt like Superman. I was afraid I was going to tear something. I didn't even want to work out. That's how strong I was and stuff.
I heard a story about you. You got to tell me if it's true. I heard, because I used to sell the PGF, you know, the prostaglandin, Lutalase.
Yes. Lutalase, yeah.
And I think it was Gary had told me, and that the little guy, that, you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, my friend, yeah.
Right. And he told me that he said that you tried the Lutalase and you tried too much. And that you had to go to the hospital because of the cramping down there. Was that true?
No. I was the first person to get Lutalase before anyone did. And
well, I sold it. I think you got it from our guy because I had it in bricks. I would never take that.
I think I got it before you because I actually had a prescription. My doctor friend wrote a prescription for it. I filled it. But I experimented with it first, and it was a 30cc bottle, if you remember. And it was a prostaglandin. It was supposed to cause localized muscle growth, which
PGF2.
Right.
PGF2.
What it basically did was you took the shot and you got the flu for 2 hours. You wanted to shit. You wanted to throw up. You felt nauseous. You got a fever. Every side effect of the flu you got, except muscle, and you got no muscle growth from it. So I couldn't get through. I probably did 20 days in a row, and I said, this is ridiculous. I feel like shit. It's not working. And it was all because someone wrote this internet article about it. Theoretically, it should have caused localized muscle growth. And all these crazy things. So I never even got through the first 30 cc's. And then I saw everyone was using it. I'm like, these guys are fucking nuts. I said, anyone who uses this is crazy. And I don't think anyone used it like longer than one bottle because no one could take it. Who the fuck wants to feel like they have the flu all the time?
I sold it to drug dealers, bro. And they would come back and tell me, dude, everybody's taking a shit. They can't fuck. Because you're supposed to take like a quarter of like a cc. It's like the craziest amount.
Right. And very small amount.
The minute you take more than that, because it's an abortion medicine, it's for abortion for cattle, and the cramping, and everybody couldn't get off the toilet.
It's like you're going into labor. That's
I would never ever take that.
Interleukin 6. You shouldn't be taking interleukin 6.
That's going to be the new big thing.
It's the new big thing. Interleukin 6.
I don't fuck with any of that shit. That prostaglandin, I used to sell it, but I heard such horror stories about it. I never tried it because
Remember,
you can't get off the toilet.
Remember El Dopa? People were selling El Dopa pills. Remember that?
That was before my time, even. Yeah.
Oh my, that's fucking like early mid '80s, maybe. Yeah, I remember El Dopa.
Remember the thiomucase ampules that were like this big? That they glass ampules?
Wasn't that percutacrine? They called it
percutacrine. Yeah.
They had suppositories too.
Topical thiomucase.
Remember the suppositories?
They came in suppository, topical, and pills.
You stick them up your butt.
No, you had to do all three together. You had to do
I never understood what the suppositories were doing.
That's stupid.
I think guys just like to stick them up their ass.
I think that's because Bleckman consulted on
it. I think that
was Mahalik that did Hey, listen, I met the American Olympic coach for weightlifting. Before they put our guys on drugs, in the Olympics, all the Russians were destroying us. And what happened is, it was in the late 50s, this guy actually worked for Jack Elaine. That's how I met him, because I started the one-on-one, and he told me the story that they were all out drinking together after the Russians beat everyone, crushed them. That's when that guy Alexia did 500 pounds over his head.
Vasily Alexey.
Yeah, when the Russian coach got drunk, he told our American guy, hey, we doing all this stuff. We doing Dianabol, and told him all the stuff they were doing.
They weren't doing Dianabol. They didn't have Dianabol. We invented Dianabol to combat all the testosterone.
They had testosterone or whatever they were doing, they were taking steroids.
But it wasn't illegal. That's the whole thing. They just had found some testosterone. So then SIBO, right? Didn't they create Dianabol in 1959?
Yes. The Germans, yeah.
No, the Germans did it
in 1935.
The Germans invented Dianabol.
Yeah, they did?
Because of the Olympics. You know why? Because they lost the track star? Jesse Johnson or whatever his name is?
Jesse Owens.
Yeah. Jesse
Owens. Jackson.
old age, but because when Jesse Owens ran and he bit the fucking Hitler, couldn't believe that shit. And after that, remember the East German chicks too? They were jacked.
I thought they were using all testosterone. And then in 1959 they invented the Dianabol in the United States. That's the timeline I have.
I remember hearing that D-ball came from
1959.
I heard the first bodybuilder to use it was Larry Scott.
Really? I wouldn't be surprised.
I don't know if that's true.
He admitted to that in an interview.
The interesting thing was it wasn't there was no negative stigma. It was like taking amino acids.
That's exactly what he said. He said we thought it was like taking some vitamins.
Yeah.
They all thought that. It wasn't until this fucking 90s and shit. Although Weider knew though back in the 70s. That's why he didn't put that. in the magazine.
I went to Weider's office, and I'm waiting for him out in the waiting part where the secretaries are, and there's right. a shelf up on the wall. You know, what was her name? Penny? Something Penny? Gregg would know. But anyway, Penny.
Penny Money. I think that's James Bond.
Yeah, no. Weider had this secretary forever. I forgot her name, but she was really sweet. So up on a shelf, up on the wall, there's a package of vials in the punch out in the
foil, yeah.
Foil. Okay, and there's like 12 or 15 of these cards with a rubber band stretched together, and there's a piece of paper over with a rubber band with a note on it, and it says for Bertel. And it's up on the shelf. He's going to come in later and make sure.
That's great.
He was an asshole, bro. He was. Oh, man. And you know what? He was so thick, but he wasn't real broad. Like, you know what I mean? Kind of like
Fox.
Slidem, yeah. Phil Hill. Remember Phil Hill?
Is Bertel Fox still in jail, John?
Yeah. Yeah. In Kids. Yeah.
He was supposed to get hung. But they commuted his punishment to life.
And you know what the reason was? Because they never had such a crime there before. So they
well, yeah, because he not only did he kill his girlfriend, but he killed his
mother too. Mother.
Right,
girlfriend and mother.
Yeah,
Mike Tyson. Haiti, right? Where's he from? Haiti,
Saint Kitts.
It's crazy, right? That's what a crazy murder that was.
Ray McNeil.
Ray McNeil, Sally McNeil shot him with a shotgun
in the face on Valentine's Day.
Yeah,
because they had an argument
with the kids in the house.
They're crazy.
Shot him in the face. Hey, I'm telling you, they're all fucking whacked. You know what I'm saying?
There's a lot of crazy people out there.
Nadler killed his wife, then killed himself.
Remember that? Yeah, he killed him. They shot each other in the heart. Remember?
Right, but I think that was him.
He shot the wife because the son was so pissed off. He's like, my father's a piece of shit. Why did he need to take my mother with him?
Dude, maybe they made a pact.
They couldn't make him. Someone they got lost money.
Yeah, but she didn't want to do it. He did. I'll tell you, I was at Nadler's office.
I didn't know that. Is that true, Gregg? Is that true that was it a murder suicide?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I thought it was a pact. I thought they both killed themselves.
Bob Bonham went to the funeral and shit, because he was really close with Nadler.
Right.
And Nadler's son was telling him that motherfucker, like, you know what I mean, on his father, because he felt like his father didn't have to take. Look, you're depressed. You want to kill yourself. You got issues. Kill yourself. But you shouldn't have took my mother with you. He killed
Bruce Nadler was a very, very successful. I don't know if he was a very good one, but he was a very successful plastic surgeon. He wasn't even board certified, but he was doing
surgeries. Oh, that guy.
Yeah. Oh, and then he went into hormone replacement. He just started prescribing, and I think he got arrested or he lost his license, right?
I think what put him over the edge with the suicide was all the money they lost in their housing.
No, but John, he lost his license. He lost his license to practice medicine, so he was like personal training people.
Wow. Yeah. Yes. Yes.
So I think he got very depressed.
If you start all over again, that's all.
A lot of people can't do that, George.
It's a little late for that.
George. What about Mihalik though? Mihalik knocked on his door. His ex-wife.
What does it matter?
Went into the fucking wife's house in front of the kids and said, "I'm going to give you something you're never going to forget." This.
Well, he's a
nice I don't know why Steve. I love Steve. I don't know why he would do something.
His health was really bad. I think he needed a kidney transplant or something like that.
He was also nuts. You know the stories. He's nuts. I knew him too. He was fucked up.
Well, I mean, I can only go by how he treated, you know, he helped, you know, when I wanted to become a pro bodybuilder, I seeked him out and he helped me. So, I mean, as far as other stuff he did, I didn't agree, you know, I didn't agree with.
He was crazy, that's all. I mean, he was an extreme person.
He was fucking crazy.
He would take me to the shows, like he would be promoting All Natural. And he had me at a high school.
Think about it, Mihalik was so, I can't do that, but
the
way Mihalik lived his life so extreme, there was no way he was going to go down and like be this convalescent guy in a nursing home. You know, he was going to go out on his own terms, and that's why he did that. I'm sure.
Well, you have to be.
What about that show I did, The Man Whose Arms Exploded? That bullshit, yeah. Right? He was in there basically calling me a fucking drug addict. And he was there, and he was natural. He was pushing that natural. If you can't do it natural, you shouldn't be. Dude, he's the king of fucking drugs.
Right. He was still prescribing them. He was still having guys use drugs, too.
Dude, I would go to the shows. He'd be there. I wouldn't talk to him because I was so angry with him. You know what I mean? Yeah. But he'd be there and he'd be with all these natural athletes. Let's get the fuck out of here, you fucking liar.
They weren't
liar.
Even natural, those guys, a lot of them.
No, they weren't.
You know why? You know who was his client? Tony Randall from The Odd Couple. And Randall told him,
"Oh right,
no publicity is bad publicity, no matter what, Steve.
That's right. He said
whether,
on my TV
whether it's
right.
negative or positive, it's all good.
Can you?
We had him on the radio show. Man, he told that story. You're right.
Dude, right. Can you picture Tony Randall?
I mean, I don't agree with that. Look,
picture
truth is better.
How he put his head underwater.
I don't know. Well, guys, we got to wrap this thing up. John's got work to do. I got work to do.
Tony Randall's head underwater. I'm sorry, Dave. Go ahead.
So after all was said and done, I guess Jimmy only gives us a couple minutes of his day, you know, but after all is said and done, what did we decide was the most potent drug cocktail, steroid cocktail? What was the best combination?
Sustanon and Trenbolone.
I agree with that, John.
I don't like.
If you don't grow with that, you're not going to.
Trenbolone is definitely, but I can't take the wait a minute. Parabolone, I used to. Matter of fact, I got arrested.
Same thing. It's Trenbolone and Anthony. Yeah.
Parabolone. That was the bad. This Trenbolone shit now is just fucking. It's bad. You know, it's somebody made it in a bathtub or something.
How about food?
That is awesome.
Isn't food the biggest drug?
Parabolone. Yeah. What's that? Yeah. What's that, Georgie?
He said, "What about food?
Isn't 85% of what growing food eating?"
Well, if you're reading the cookies, you know what I mean?
The drug combination that made me the strongest, where I actually was able to function and eat my food, because I couldn't eat. Orals killed my appetite, so they weren't even good for me. Trenbolone, testosterone, and injectable Dianabol. Remember the injectable Dianabol? The best.
That's the one I stuck in my bicep and caught a fucking infection from that. You know what I didn't like? You know what I didn't like about the injectable? Reforbid B, the injectable.
I didn't use that one. It had B vitamins in it.
Yep.
Oh, my God. But later on, you have like acid indigestion, and you got like that foul vitamin. You ever eat, you know when you eat a lot of
vitamins? You were overdosing on vitamins with that stuff.
Oh my God, bro!
I like the Dankel version. Dankel had an injectable D-ball. It was great.
I don't know. I liked Sustanon, Anadrol. I liked the Anadrol, and then I liked Wiganabol, like with an EQ.
EQ would help you eat better. So that was always good.
I had a good EQ and Deca stack, 600 each a week.
They're too much alike. They compete for the same receptor, though.
I don't know. I don't agree with that. I like to mix those two together, but I think you need testosterone in there.
How many meals a day do you eat? Let's go to food. How many meals a day do you eat?
12 feedings a day. That was the shakes, too. So that was my
non-stop, relentless, year after year after year.
Year round.
Dave, don't you ever miss when I saw pictures of you the other day. Don't you ever miss? I mean, I miss being jacked. You don't miss being jacked?
No, I'm too scared now. I want to, everything's breaking now. If I was that big, I'd be dead probably. So it's nice to look back and say, yeah, I used to look like that. That's good. You know, at least I accomplished something that I can have records of. You know, that's the important thing.
Well, you got to set new goals. You got new goals, Dave.
That's right. That's right.
Are you building a? I had an idea. Why not once a month we do a show where we're all together? Because I see you doing a whole bunch of construction on your thing. Why don't you build a big giant dorm where we can come down there and stay for a weekend and we can shoot four shows?
I'd be divorced. you guys want to get any of Mr. G's Jumbo Palumbo cookies or the Jumbo Lights? You can go to Mr. Potts. protein.net, and they've got some great new stuff up there. You can check out whatever the latest and greatest is up on his site. John, if you want to catch your podcast, how do we do that?
Just Apple Podcasts, Apple iTunes, Spotify, YouTube. Just type in Fitness, Fame, and Fortune.
Right. And Gregg, what's your next appearance? You going to be on the – are you doing any more Generation Iron stuff?
Yeah, I still do Generation Iron. If I got to get back with Patrick Bet-David. I blew them off and I, you know.
Never. You got to get on that show.
He's got a, you know, his guy there. You know what I'm saying? They call him. I got to show you some stuff. But
okay.
So, I got to see if they still want me to come back because I blew them off in February because of the throat.
Yeah, believe me, they'll want to get you on there. I'm sure of it. Yeah. So, and you know me, and you know what I do.
Hold on. What about Jimmy the Bull? Hey, so Jimmy the Bull, what do you do? Well, I got these gloves, Muscle Bob. Yo.
Well, in my head, I know that it's time to wrap this thing up.
Let Mr. G end it with the truth.
Yeah, give me the truth.
Yeah, give us the truth.
I am the truth.
I am the truth.
I am Mr. G, and I say, listen to the Whack Pack Show. If you, and yes, all of you across the world want to hear the truth.
See you next week, guys.